Welcome, movie fans, to another episode of Hollow Victories, where two movies enter and one too many of them leave. We're repeating intros now. I've run out of intros. I'm your host, Matt Presents, and I am joined, as always, by my post-apocalyptic co-host.
I was never given a name. Could you name me, Matt?
How about, I call you, Richard Kelly.
Richard Kelly, sure. Who's Richard Kelly?
The director of Southland Tales.
Oh.
And today we've got an interesting matchup. It's, dystopian. I think I called them post-apocalyptic last time. The one of them is post-apocalyptic. The other, I think, is just dystopian.
Yeah.
Two dystopian films that went way, 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 way overboard.
I think they've got the apocalypse in both of them to an extent.
That's fair. That's fair.
I'm just now realizing that this fucking Richard Kelly guy is the same one who made the fucking box movie where it's like, if you push this button, you'll get $1 million, but someone you don't know will die.
I'm sorry, you've seen his other movie, but not Donnie Darko.
No, I saw the trailers, and that's really okay. All I needed.
Okay.
I saw a skit that I liked that I never actually watched the movie, where someone says, like, if you press this button, someone you don't know will die. Before he gets to finish the rest of it, the guy pushes the button.
Richard Kelly's Southland Tales versus Kevin Reynolds' quote-unquote Waterworld. And Michael, would you like to start us off by talking about Waterworld?
Sure. So Waterworld is a movie released in 1995, though we are talking about one of the extended versions, directed by Kevin Reynolds. And it's basically just about like a post-apocalyptic world after the melting of polar ice caps. Most of the world is covered in water, but there are some humans who survive that have like their own civilizations that, you know, like are basically just like these little small areas that are above the water. There's no actual islands, although like there's rumors of the dry land that they're trying to find in this movie. But at the core of all of this, we have Kevin Costner, a unnamed character, hence my little joke at the start of this episode. Who is part human and part fish. He has gills and he's able to breathe underwater.
He's fully human. He's just like a mutation,
yeah,
that has given him gills.
Right. And he goes to this like little civilization that's like just kind of like float, like this floating area. It's not actual land, but it is like people do live there, but they're running low on supplies and they're getting desperate. And he gives them dirt that he found.
He's got a jar of dirt.
Yeah, he has a jar of dirt, and he does that in exchange for water, fresh water. But then once they like notice the gills, they trap him because they see him as a freak, despite the fact that they could probably use them to solve a majority of their problems. But hey, fuck that. And they're gonna kill him. But then there's this other group of people that want to abduct this little girl that lives in the town because she has a tattoo on the back of her neck that serves as a map to the dry land, which they're all trying to find. So Kevin Costner, his love interest in this, who's looking after this little girl, and the little girl all escape in search of the dry land, except little do they know Kevin Costner has no intention of showing them the dry land because he doesn't even believe it exists, and a lot of other shenanigans happen along the way.
Yeah, that about covers it.
Yep. So what do we think of Waterworld, Matt?
I think it is a pretty enjoyable little, like, Mad Max riff on the water that got blown entirely out of proportion. like Kevin Costner, and probably not just Kevin Costner, but definitely Kevin Costner especially, wanted this to be so much more than it was.
Right.
The first time I saw this, I was like, yeah, this is like a fun little Mad Max thing. They're trying too hard, but it's a fun little Mad Max thing. Well, today I was watching like the behind-the-scenes documentary. Apparently, it started out as a low-budget Mad Max ripoff. It was just supposed to be Mad Max on the water. And that was like the mid-80s, and this didn't come out until the mid-90s. So things changed a lot.
And, oh man, I just discovered something, which we'll get to when we get to casting. So, yeah, staying on focus. Yeah, you definitely have, like, a Mad Max vibe going there, but it's on the water. I think that this movie has some cool stuff to show you. But at the end of the, like, when you really look at it as a whole, it's not... There's just too much working against it. Like, I'll say this, Kevin Costner and Jeanne, I hope I'm saying her name right, Jeanne Triplehorn, not very interested in leads. Not very interested in leads at all.
No.
But then you do have, like, a lot of really cool, like, mechanical stuff they have in this movie. His boat is very interesting. This civilization that he finds is very interesting. And then some of the characters, like Dennis Hopper, is just such a fucking treat in this movie.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, we could talk about the caliber of acting in this. We usually hold off on that, but I am willing to just go right into the acting.
Yeah, I mean, I'm fine with that, too. I'm not trying to rush it. I'm just trying to say, like, general thoughts. There are things that I
have a lot to say about both of these. I am prepared to be here as long as we... If this episode is 2 hours long, we'll make a 2 hour long episode. Fuck it.
I'll say this much. I think that I right off the bat I have something very interesting to say about the casting, but I think the bottom line is, like, I think there's things about this movie that do work really well, and I think that there's things about this movie that make it kind of dull and kind of uninteresting, and it definitely wants to have more meaning than it actually does. Like, a lot of the emotional scenes don't work very well, but it's 3 hours long, and really, I wasn't bored until the very end of it, so that's...
Really?
That can be a compliment. What?
I was bored more in the middle. Like, the first... Honestly, like, the first hour of this flies by. Like, we got to the end of the first hour, and I'm like, whoa, we're already an hour in. But then after that, like, the middle part of the movie really slows down. But I like the climax on Dennis Hopper's barge.
We did talk about this the night we watched it. Yeah, it definitely has a more interest in the third hour than second hour, but it's also just by the third hour, I was ready to be done watching it, you know?
I get you, like... And if the second hour was gone, I don't think the third hour would be as boring.
Yeah.
Or if the second hour was like 30 minutes.
It definitely didn't need to be as long as it was, but it was trying...
I mean, in fairness, we watched the Ulysses cut.
Yeah.
Which is slightly longer than the theatrical cut. Although I've seen the theatrical cut, and it's way too long, too.
Yeah, I think that... The second hour, it's trying really hard to have, it's really trying hard to make you care about the characters. It's just, the characters aren't, they're just not great characters, you know?
Yeah.
Like, whenever back to Dennis Hopper, you're having fun, but Kevin Costner and Jeanne Triplehorn, like, I don't know, they're not, like, the worst ever, but they're not, but I mean, Kevin Costner's pretty unlikable.
I don't think Kevin Costner is a good actor. I don't know why people liked Kevin Costner so much. I was trying to think of, like, any movie of his that I have enjoyed. And to be fair, Untouchables. Untouchables is a great movie. But I don't like that movie because of Kevin Costner. Honestly, Kevin Costner is, like, the least interesting. He's like, the quiet, stoic lead. And he works in that role. But everyone around him is so much more interesting than he is.
Yeah, I haven't seen a lot of his movies. You know, the thing, I've joked about this before, but it's true. The thing I know him most for is a throwaway line in both Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul. And anyone who has seen those shows knows exactly what I'm talking about. And that's what I know most about Kevin Costner, because I don't think he's an actor that's left a big impression on me. He's very boring in this, but at the same time, there's actors who genuinely get on my fucking nerves.
I mean,
and he's not one of them.
That's fair. I just think he's a really dull actor.
Yeah.
Right. Like he is pretty consistently boring.
Right.
Have you seen Field of Dreams was in? Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves.
That's actually another film from this director.
It is. We will get to the director. We have to talk about Kevin Costner and the director. Jesus, put a pin in that.
Okay.
I was about to actually compliment Kevin Costner. There is one movie I like him in. It's JFK. He's good in JFK.
Okay.
I apologize. There is one Kevin Costner movie where I like him. It is not just everyone around him I like.
Did you know Waterworld was nominated for a Golden Raspberry?
It doesn't surprise me.
Is for worst director. I think that's a little harsh. I don't think Waterworld is like...
Yeah. Yeah. I mean... But there were also behind-the-scenes drama that, like, might have influenced that.
Maybe. Because, like, yeah, the raspberries are, like... You know, they are, like, whatever's popular, right? So if there was controversy, that could be what does it, you know?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, like, the directing I don't think is that bad in the movie. Like, there's some good shots, there's some cool set pieces, there's, like, definitely scenes that should have been cut. I don't know why the fuck we have that scene with the pedophile coming onto the boat. I don't see any value in that scene, because it's like, oh, you can say it's, like, him sticking up for the two girls, but it's after he was, like, going to let that happen, so it's kind of, like, hard to give that as like, oh, that's points to Kevin Costner's character. No, I still think he's shitty after that scene.
Yeah, no, I think that was just there to like kill someone. It's like, okay, we need like some action here. Pedophile shows up, why not?
Yeah, cut that shit out. That character did annoy me. The performance did get on my fucking nerves.
You know who is not in this movie, and it honestly shocked me?
Yeah.
You know Flea from the Red Hot Chili Peppers?
Sure.
There's like five different people in this movie. There's like five characters in this movie. I'm like, oh, it's Flea, and it never was. Flea is not in this movie. But there's like five different people in this movie that look just like him.
Okay. yeah, I don't know.
I'll send you a picture of him. I'm sure you've seen this man before.
Okay. Yeah, I have, like, family that really like the Red Hot Chili Peppers. I've never been a big Red Hot Chili Peppers guy. I do have a fun fact about this movie. You know what I just learned?
What?
We've got an actor in this movie who was in both this and Southland Tales.
Yes. Yes, we do.
Yeah, Sab Shiamono? Sab Shiamono? I don't know how to say the name.
Something like that.
I looked at like the cast and I looked at him. I was like, he looks like the guy who got his hand cut off. And I looked it up and it's like, yeah, he is the guy who got his hand cut off in Southland Tales.
Yeah, there's like so many actors in both of these, and I'm going through like all of their IMDb's. Like, okay, have we done one of, are they in a Hollow Victories movie? No, okay.
But yeah, Sab Shiamono, he welcome to the club.
Yeah, welcome to the club.
We need to just, like, make an IMDb list of, like, Hollow Victory actors. And we, like, the order of the list is, like, based on, like, where they rank in the number of appearances. I'll put that together.
Mm-hmm. Now, shit, her name's not on the back of the box. And you said it, and I've already forgotten it.
Jean Triplehorn.
Jean Triplehorn. She's fine. Like,
I'm not, I mean, the performance is fine. I don't like the character. The character's boring.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I'm with you on that one. Apparently she had a bigger role earlier on, but then they're like, nah, it's starring Kevin Costner. We're making this all about Kevin Costner.
Mm. I mean, I'd say she had a pretty big role in this. She's in most of the movie, but I guess maybe it's like just like the significance, because in this movie, she's like a character who's there for Kevin Costner. rather than, like, you know, her own character, I guess. It's a character for the main character to fall in love with, you know, even though they do a really fucking bad job setting that up. Like, they just make him way too fucking mean-spirited in the movie. They make him do way too many bad things to have, like, the turnaround. Like, if you want to make him that nasty, you need to, like, either make the part where he becomes a better person a little bit more mild. Because you can't have them, like, act like, oh, he's such a good guy, if, like, from this, like, 10 minutes after he intentionally throws them off the boat. But you also, or you got to go in the route where he's just not a good, a great guy. And the film acknowledges it. Or yeah, better I mean, yet, like, just don't make him act like a fucking dickhead the entire movie.
Like, Mad Max is, like, Max from those movies. He's, like, a pretty bad guy sometimes, but it's always to just, like, random evil dudes wandering out in the desert, and it's like, yeah, I'm not really sad to see him go. And this one, you have, like, a woman and her child, and it's like,
yeah,
okay, be nicer to them.
Yeah, no, he's throwing a temper tantrum because the little girl plays with his crayons. Like, it's not a... He is not a very endearing character. All right, so we have Tina Majorino as the kid.
Yes.
It's fine for a kid performance.
She played Deb in Napoleon Dynamite.
Wow. Didn't leave much of an impression on me in this movie, neither the kid or the... it could have been annoying and it didn't annoy me.
She is just kind of a MacGuffin character, though.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's like, oh, she's got the tattoo that tells you how to get to dry land.
But they do have a scene where Dennis Hopper hits a child.
Yes.
Let's talk about Dennis Hopper.
My God, I love Dennis Hopper. That's the thing, like, you've got Kevin Costner, who I think is, like, one of the most overrated actors of all time. He's such a boring performer. And then playing opposite him, you have the most entertaining actor out there. I love Dennis Hopper so much. Now, this is late career Dennis Hopper. This is like post Mario movie Dennis Hopper, where he's just like chewing scenery. But you know what? I love that Dennis Hopper just as much as I like him in like his prime.
Right. I think that he's very entertaining in this, and he's, like, having a lot of fun making it, and, yeah, he is a treat. He's a treat for, like, I wish he was in more of it, but he's not even in, like, he's in a fair amount of it at the same time. Like, you do get to see a decent bit of him, but it's just, like, objectively, he's a more interesting person to follow. But I get it, you can't have him as the main character.
Yes.
Jack Black is weirdly in this.
Yeah, Jack Black is, like, this pilot guy, and he and Dennis Hopper have a scene together. So yeah. It's like, hey, look, Bowser and President Koopa together,
right,
at last.
Right, I forgot about that. Yeah. Both Bowsers. Now we just need Bob Hoskins and Chris Pratt in a movie, except that's not possible.
Yeah, unfortunately.
Yeah.
We could get Charlie Day and John Leguizamo.
Sadly, Chris Pratt did pass away.
God, I wish. I mean, I don't wish death on Chris Pratt. I do not wish death on Chris Pratt.
Or just wishing it was like we had Bob Hoskins still.
I would trade Chris Pratt for Bob Hoskins. I would do that.
I don't hate Chris Pratt. He's fine as, like, you give him the right part and he's fine. But I guess this is the wrong episode to be talking about that.
yeah, it tuck our Mario discussions away for another day.
Yep.
Any other actors in Waterworld you wanted to mention? Because there are a lot of actors in this.
There is Michael Jeter, who plays like the old, is he the one who's, his name is Old Gregor, is that the one who has like the, oh, what would you call it? It's not really a hot air balloon, it's like,
oh, yeah, like the Zeppelin, yeah, thing.
I thought,
you know, you know what? Both of these movies had Zeppelins in them. What do you know?
Yeah, you're right.
These are connected.
I thought he was okay. Like, he's trying to give kind of like a wit, like a goofier performance, but I was completely fine with his performance in this, you know, had a little bit of personality. Yeah, I liked it.
he is the type of character you want to see in this type of movie. Just right. like some wacky inventor guy.
Mm-hmm. I think he delivered his lines well. I do want to mention William Preston, because he got my he has my favorite moment in the movie, the one part that genuinely made me laugh hard. At the end of the movie where Kevin Costner drops that torch down into that oil, down into the oil, and he's like, he's just, you see him earlier in the movie, he works down there and he just has a miserable fucking existence. And when he sees the flame go down, he's not concerned. His response is, oh, thank God. And that joke was really dark, but also really out of place with the rest of the movie. Like, they weren't making jokes like that in this movie, but that it caught me so off guard, and the performance and the shot of the flames reflecting his goggles, like, it was perfect. Like, I thought that was comedy gold. And I'll say this much, it's not always easy to make a suicide joke funny, but it's not really suicide, but, you know, suicidal joke funny, but I think they pulled it off.
Yeah. No, that was a funny moment.
Yeah, it's my favorite moment in the entire movie.
I love that Kevin Costner just blows up the oil tanker.
It's like so cynical too, because that like in the in terms of like Kevin Costner being the good guy, he did just kill an innocent person. But like, it just makes the joke funnier, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That's about all who I wanted to talk about. Is there anyone else you wanted to mention?
Not really. I mean, there's some names on here. Artie Call, Gerard Murphy. But yeah, I don't have much to say about anyone else, I don't think.
What should we move on to next, then? Good.
We could talk about the director of this film.
Let's do it.
Kevin Reynolds. Now, Kevin Reynolds had worked with Kevin Costner before, and they had maybe a little bit of animosity between them, but he was interested in Waterworld, Kevin Costner was interested in Waterworld, and Costner outright said he would only do the movie if Kevin Reynolds directed.
Hmm.
And then they get out there on the ocean, because here's the thing, the director, Kevin Reynolds, called Steven Spielberg and asked him if he had any advice for, like, filming on the ocean, and Spielberg's response was, don't do it. And he was right. They spent way more time out there than they had initially planned. It was way harder to deal with than they thought it would be. And so, you know, tensions are high, egos are clashing. Kevin Reynolds left the movie late in production, and from there it seems like Kevin Costner was mostly in charge of directing the film. Now, to these men's credit, they have kept pretty quiet about this. Right, like, it's known that he got fired from the movie, but they have like barely talked about it since then. Like, I watched the hour and 40 minute making of documentary, and all they did, they mentioned that he got fired, and that was it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, come on, that's the one thing I was watching this for. I wanted to know the juicy drama. I want to know how he got fired. But no, I mean, it's fair enough. We're not gonna step on each other's toes. Where I am leaving the project amicably.
Yeah. It just would have made a better... I hear you, though. It would have made a better documentary, but it's like, okay, they're being, like, respectful towards each other.
Fuck that. I want to see some mudslinging, man.
At that point, you just don't make the movie. The behind the scenes. Like, if you can't get the most interesting part of what that documentary would be, don't make the documentary. I mean,
Still, it was people making... This movie had the highest budget of any movie upon release. and they filmed this whole movie out in the ocean. It's like, it's honestly an incredible feat what they have done. It's amazing that this movie exists.
Right.
You know?
Right, yeah. Because, like, I mean, nowadays they would have just, like, all of it, this would have been effects. All of it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And I do have some appreciation for the movie for that. It feels like something that someone actually wanted to make, and it has some cool stuff in it, and it has some entertaining stuff in it. It's just, as a whole, it's like, yeah, a lot of it doesn't really work that well. But I can appreciate things about it. I never want to watch it again, but I don't mind that I watched it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. If I watched it again, I would certainly watch the shorter cut.
Probably, yeah, probably the same. And I might even, like, I might even skip through parts of it unless I'm showing it to someone.
Honestly, I'm sure you could take this movie and cut it down to, like, a 2-hour version that's, like, significantly better.
Yeah.
There's still some stuff you can't save in this movie. Like, Kevin Costner's performance, he's still gonna be Kevin Costner no matter what. But you could certainly make this less dramatic, less trying to be deep, but not really succeeding.
Mm-hmm.
What else do you talk about with this movie?
I'm trying to think.
Something of note with this movie, it opens with a unique Universal Pictures logo with, like, the whole Earth setting. So did Cat in the Hat.
Yeah.
So we've got two movies in a row with unique Universal logos in them.
Yeah, we gotta try to remember those unique logos. Sometimes Fox had some, sometimes Paramount had some. What's the one with the, like, one woman? It's not the Statue of Liberty, but it's like...
Oh, Columbia?
Columbia, yeah. Eight Crazy Nights has their iconic character take her place.
I think it is supposed to be the Statue of Liberty, actually. Is it? Or like the woman the Statue of Liberty is based on or something.
That makes sense. Yeah, Simpsons movie had Ralph Wiggum come out.
Mm-hmm.
And do the humming. but yeah, no, like, yeah, it did have, I do like it when they, like, do unique things with the logo. Fucking Shark Tale made the DreamWorks logo a canonical part of the movie. Cause it means like, that does mean that Shark Tale is, like, the official DreamWorks movie, you know?
Yes, it is the DreamWorks movie.
Yeah. It's, like, the one that they clearly have the most respect for, even to this day. I guess I don't have too much else to say about it. I mean, like, if there's another specific thing you want to point out, absolutely, I'm down for the conversation. But with this one, it's just like, yeah, it's neat. They did some cool stuff with it, but too many of, like, the most integral parts of a movie aren't there. Like,
maybe we should focus a little more on, like, the positives of the movie, right? Because, like, mm-hmm. there's some really impressive stunts in this movie.
Yeah.
I love, like, the costume and set design. It's mm-hmm. it's a really good looking movie.
Oh yeah.
I mean, the effects are bad. The special effects are bad.
There's not a lot of them though.
There's not a lot of them. And, yeah, and also
there's that one, like, fish. There's that one, like, creature that they kill to get, like, they finally eat after that. Yeah. And that looked really bad, but there isn't a lot of moments like that.
And there's also, like, the like, blue screen when he's taking her down to, like, the underwater city is not very good.
No.
Although, in fairness, Dennis Hopper's barge at the end, that was all on a soundstage somewhere. Mm-hmm. They just, like, green screen the ocean in, and that looks fine. It does look like it's out on the ocean.
Hmm.
Also, from what I have heard, apparently they were sort of beaten around the bush about, like, the climax of this movie, and at some point they're like, okay, no, hold on, we can't have the climax set on water. We are done with the fucking water. Build us an actual set. So they built the barge to be, like, a solid set that they could film on.
Yeah, I mean, that sounds like a nightmare. I mean, yeah, I think you can get.
Oh yeah, this was an absolute nightmare production. Like, I can't fucking imagine.
Yeah, like, you'd have to. Yeah, I mean, there's just too much working against you if you do that. Like, bad weather could be a thing that, like, fucks up so much, you know.
Yeah, I might be wrong about this, but I think that whole, like, set from the beginning got destroyed at some point, or at least, like, partially destroyed, and they had to rebuild it.
Wow.
For the next shoot.
God. That was, like, a pretty big set, too. It was pretty detailed.
Yeah.
There's a lot of stuff there. I can appreciate that set a lot, because there's almost, like, a dream-like feel into it. Like, it's very... It is a cool set. I like a lot of the nighttime shots where you just have that one guy, like, again, that weird, like, inventor character just running around in his, like, little lab. But it's still, like, above water. You still see, like, there's no, like, full walls surrounding anything. So, like, these little buildings, you can still see the outside world for all of them. Like, it's cool. It's cool set design. And there is, like, it almost seems like living on something like that could be, like, fun for a day, you know? But, like, life there forever would be, like, completely miserable.
Yeah.
Although it is funny with that in mind that the set was destroyed within, like, a short period of time. Like, Waterworld would not exist in real life, but suspension of disbelief.
That was something I was going to mention is that, like, the whole setup for this is, like, the polar ice caps have melted because global warming. Now, in the initial script, they didn't explain why the world was covered in water, but Kevin Costner specifically wanted this to be, like, an eco message. He wanted to have an environmental message with the film. So it's like, oh, the polar ice caps melted and the world's flooded. If all of the ice on Earth melted, sea levels would rise, like, not that far. Like, no, it would be bad. A lot of stuff would get destroyed. A lot of stuff would be underwater. But it would not be Waterworld. There would still be plenty of land.
No, Waterworld was caused by someone who forgot to turn their hose off.
Oh, yeah, of course. Makes sense.
Oh, he, like, wakes up. Like, that's the main character. Oh, no. Oh, he has to try to blend in and not let anyone know that he's the one who caused Waterworld.
This almost sounds like this could be like a Treehouse of Horror parody of Waterworld. It's like Homer left the sprinkler on and now the entire world's flooded.
Yeah, there was an episode of Simpsons where I don't remember if Homer did it, but Springfield's like flooded and Homer does something. No, Homer does flood Springfield in one of the episodes. Yeah. But it's not a Treehouse of Horror. It's completely canon.
Well, that checks out too. I just meant if they wanted to do like a Waterworld parody, where they flood the entire world.
Yeah, right. I don't know if Waterworld would be on the top of their priorities though for a Treehouse of Horror. How big of a hit was this movie? Because, I mean, bad critical reception doesn't mean it wasn't, like, selling tickets.
Well, I mean, like I said, it was the most expensive movie ever made at the time. I think it has since been passed by one of the Pirates of the Caribbean movies.
Okay. Both have something to do with water. Okay, from now on, no water on the set.
I mean, probably that's why that Pirates of the Caribbean movie was as expensive as it was, because it was so much of it was set on the water.
Yeah.
Like, filming on water is a nightmare. But it was the most expensive film ever made at the time, so it was kind of like doomed to flop. It did turn a little bit of a profit, but only after it was like out on VHS. So I'm sure it was a disappointment for anyone who had put money into it.
Right.
That said, it was successful enough that there was a Waterworld stunt show at Universal Studios.
Huh.
Which, I mean, like I said, the stunts are one of the most impressive parts of the movie, so, like,
yeah,
give us a Waterworld stunt show, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah, fair enough. Stuff like, from like a technical standpoint, there were a lot of shots I liked. Again, like I already mentioned, set design. Music doesn't really stand out to me. Like, all of it was forgettable. But I don't remember there being, like, any bad music in the movie or anything. But score was pretty underwhelming. But yeah, I mean, there's stuff to appreciate about this one. Like, this one's not that bad. It's just, it's almost like kind of like a shame, you know, like if someone other than Kevin Costner was there. To be fair though, give Kevin Costner some credit. It sounds like if he unless he's the one who caused Reynolds to leave, if there was like a feud between the two of them, I'd say he's the one who like saved the movie. Like, he's the one who allowed it to be completed, but that just depends. Why exactly did Kevin Reynolds quit?
Yeah, I mean, I think it was creative differences and Generally, in these cases, I want to side with the director, especially because I'm not, like, a huge Kevin Costner fan. At the same time, from what I've heard, he wanted to make it, like, longer and darker. And I'm like, yeah, that sounds bad. Like, how long and how dark this gets are really, like, the two biggest problems with it. If this were just, like, a silly, over-the-top action movie, it'd be so much better.
Yeah, like, stay in your lane, all right? You don't, and, like, I don't know, like, you can have something, if you want it to be more meaningful, you can find subtle ways. To do that, like people overinterpret fucking Star Wars all the time, and that first movie is like, you know, it's a really simple, fun movie, you know.
Yeah,
it's not trying to do anything too harsh. You can do that with something like Waterworld, but like, if you're a creative enough person, you can like find meaning in certain things. If people love it enough because they had such a good time watching it, they can go through and like interpret certain things.
I think Star Wars certainly has something to say,
yeah,
but it's not doing it the way Waterworld is.
I think it's a little bit more subtle about it than Waterworld is, you know?
Yes. As far as, like, a mess, I suppose there is some stuff in there about, like, you know, being nice to each other, but that's kind of what you get in a post-apocalyptic film.
Right.
Mainly the message is like, oh, well, it's global warming.
Damn global warming. I don't know. Is there, like, good global warming movies? Because I think global warming is something that needs to be taken seriously. But, like, it feels like most times when someone tries to make a movie about it, it's not really subtle.
Steven Seagal's On Deadly Ground.
Okay.
I'm joking.
I know.
That movie's hilarious because it's a Steven Seagal movie with an environmentalist message. But it's still just a Steven Seagal movie. Like, it's a completely normal run-of-the-mill Seagal movie, except, like, the villain is, like, an oil billionaire
I've got a good one.
Go ahead.
Birdemic Shock and Terror. That one has a good environmentalist message about global warming.
I think Miyazaki has done good environmental messages. Maybe not global warming specifically, but he is very concerned about the environment. And right. I think he does it well. He does it, like, with some semblance of subtlety. Like, enough that you get, okay, well, you know, we should take care of the environment, but not so much that he's, like, hitting you over the head with it.
Right, because it's, like, it's good to have that in there, but not beat you over. I don't know, it's hard when someone's beating you over the head of something like that, it's kind of hard to take it seriously. And that's how most people, like, approach it. I feel like in that sense, like, documentaries are the best thing to watch when it comes to learning about, like, climate change.
That was a good movie. An Inconvenient Truth.
An Inconvenient Truth.
That was a line from Birdemic.
Oh. I forgot. I'm the one who brought Birdemic into this and I couldn't even get your reference.
Yeah, I mean, in fairness, I don't think Waterworld really leans into the environmentalist angle at all. It's like, oh, it's the world is covered in water because of global warming, and that's where it begins and ends, you know?
Yeah, fair enough. So, I'm trying to think if I have anything else to say, because you did bring a little bit more out of me with that, but, yeah, I don't know, It's definitely one of the okayer movies we've watched for the show.
I agree. I think everything that works about it is tied to its, like, action-y Mad Max roots. I think the deviation from that original idea is what is killing it. But overall, it's still, like, decently enjoyable.
Yeah.
You know, the movie we could throw in here, like the third feature for this, like, matchup... is Michael Camino's Heaven's Gate, because that one also went like super ridiculous. Like when Waterworld was happening, people called it Kevin's Gate because of how over budget it was going, as a direct jab at Heaven's Gate, a movie that went wildly over budget.
Oh.
Although my biggest problem with Heaven's Gate is it's like five different stories all crammed into one movie, and any one of those stories would be infinitely more interesting as its own movie, like separated from this mammoth, like over, what's the word I'm looking for here? It's too much. It's yeah. Way too much.
Overcompensated? I don't know.
Maybe. It's too much. There's too much going on in that movie, and it's like if you had just reined it in and focused on one of these characters, it would yeah. be a much better movie. And that is a very good segue right. into our next film.
Yes, it is. Go ahead, Matt.
So, in the other corner, we've got Southland Tales, a film from Richard Kelly, who just prior to this had made the smash indie hit Donnie Darko. The film takes place in the distant future of 2008, when a nuclear bomb has gone off in the city of Abilene, Texas, more or less kickstarting World War III and giving a lot of power to emboldening the conservatives around America. Essentially causing the dissolution of the Democratic Party. But this, of course, gives rise to new, more radical left-wing movements, in particular, the neo-Marxists. And that is the world this story finds us in when we meet the main character, played by Dwayne The Rock Johnson, boxer... Shoot, what's his last name?
Santoros.
Boxer Santoros, played by Dwayne The Rock Johnson, who is suffering from amnesia but has just finished a screenplay with his new girlfriend, Krista Now, who is a porn star. In this movie, as it happens, is like a prediction of the future, and in it, Boxer is supposed to play this character named Jericho Kane, and throughout the movie you sort of see him embody Jericho Kane more and more. There are other characters who embody other roles in their screenplay, some knowingly, some unknowingly. Now early on, Boxer is doing a ride along with a cop for this role in his screenplay, The Power. This cop is supposed to be Roland Tavner. However, Roland has been kidnapped by the neo-Marxist and replaced with his twin brother, Ronald.
Yes.
Both played by Sean William Scott. With the intent to stage a murder that will help kickstart the revolution. Of course, when they show up to where they're supposed to stage the murder, there ends up being an actual police officer there, and he actually kills those people. But of course, later it's revealed that maybe he's working with the neo-Marxists. At the very least, like, one of the neo-Marxists knew he was gonna be there, and he gets her the footage. It's a little unclear.
Yeah.
Also in there you have like Krista Now and her friends blackmailing this Texas senator who Boxer Santoros is married to the senator's daughter, but since he has amnesia, he doesn't remember being married to her, and he's been having sex with Krista. So now they're blackmailing him with footage of Boxer having sex with Krista. Also there's this whole thing about liquid karma, which is this like water-based fuel source. It's a mess. It's honestly really hard to follow most of what is going on in this movie.
Yeah.
So Michael, tell us what you thought.
I thought that this movie was fucking bullshit. I thought that it was trying way too fucking much at once. I think that it's like switching around characters so often that it's just like throwing so much at you that you don't even really have time to focus on anything. I feel like really at the end of the day, it's trying to be this big satire on just America in general. Like, because it's trying to tackle everything, you know, it's trying to make a point out of everything, but eventually you gotta, like, you gotta focus a little bit. Like, there's movies that I've seen that are able to, like, you know, like, okay, you don't have to, like, focus on one thing in your movie. There's movies that do a really good job of, like, taking on multiple topics. One of my favorite animated movies, Mary and Max, is a movie that I feel like covers a lot of ground, a lot of different subjects. A lot of my favorite movies do that, honestly, where it's not necessarily about one thing, but they're always more focused. Where this one, it's like, what do you even want to say with this? This, it really, I listened to this video where someone compared it to a bunch of people like in a room smoking weed and having a conversation. That's what this movie feels like. It's just a fucking clusterfuck.
What this movie feels like to me is like, this is like a bizarre look into the creative process. Because this is the movie that exists in, like, every writer's mind at any given moment, right? But usually, you know, there's, like, scenes and characters and music and lines you have, but you don't have them organized yet. You haven't made them into a movie yet. This is just sort of... this feels like the idea phase of a movie.
Right. Yeah, I agree with that. I think that's actually a perfect way to describe it, as something in your head where it's like, this is what you're thinking of, and then you're like, I'll fix it later.
Yeah, right.
Minus the fixing it later.
Honestly, apparently this one was a lot simpler earlier in the writing process, too, because he wrote this, like, before 9/11, and it was just supposed to be, like, a satire of Hollywood. And you can kind of see that in there with, like, the boxer and Krista story going on.
Probably a lot better.
But then 9/11 happened and the Patriot Act happened, and he was trying to make this big commentary on the Bush administration. This is so fucking dated. This so obviously came out during the Bush administration. Mm-hmm. Like, it is painfully obvious this was a Bush-era film.
If you want me to just go as, like, broad with my thoughts as possible, I would use that word to describe the whole movie. Painful. Here's the thing. It's the only reason I'm not ranking this one right with Joysticks, and there's actually more than one reason, so I shouldn't say the only reason. The reasons I'm not ranking this with Joysticks and Avatar, I guess I should say The Last Airbender, if that is, the only reason I think that it's not, like, third to last, like, there's a few things I put in front of, is because there's one, it's someone's passion project. I believe that I will always respect these movies more than Garfield. like, live action Garfield, I should specify. But I also think that there's sequences that are good, like, they're interesting. I shouldn't say they're good, because there's not really a fully understood purpose behind them, but there's, like, something there that could work. Like, I like the, and this isn't on the actual film, this is on the extended version watched, I liked that found footage opening scene.
That's in the original.
Okay.
I will say, I think both of these movies, the theatrical cut is stronger. In Waterworld, it's just because the theatrical cut's shorter. In this case, we actually watched the Cannes cut, the version he showed at Cannes Film Festival, and people were apparently confused, so he went back and added an introduction to the theatrical cut that I sent you earlier today.
Yeah.
And I think that does clear up a lot. It's kind of a blunt way to do it. Also, it feels a lot like it's a fucking Starship Troopers ripoff, but it covers, like, the things you probably should know going into the movie.
I kind of hate it at the same time, though, because it's like, it's just throwing a bunch of shit at you to start off with, and it's like, that's not an endearing way to start a movie. That's like, what? Okay. Like, I do not like movies that open like that.
Do you want to know something weird about this movie?
Sure.
Because in this movie, it's broken up into chapters, but we only get chapters 4, 5, and 6. Because chapters 1, 2, and 3 were graphic novels.
Yeah, I heard about that, actually.
During production. And I read the graphic novels. They do not go a long way to clearing things up. There are a few things that make a little more sense, Like, it makes sense how the, like, there are a bunch of characters in the film that just happen to have their screenplay, and the graphic novels explain how that happened. Also, Will Sasso's character, they try to do, like, a twist with him near the, like, a backstab with him near the end, but it's like, we've seen this character in one scene. I don't know who this is. And yeah. He has a bigger role in the graphic novels. So that twist would probably be a little more effective to someone who's read the graphic novels. At the same time, the graphic novels are real sketchy in style, and they honestly look more like storyboards for like scenes that were deleted from the film.
Yeah, I don't know.
It just seems ridiculous to expect people to read three books before they come into your movie.
And I mean, it's not from the sounds of it, you would have to like... You said it's like 4, 5, and 6, right? That's what we get in the movie?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, I agree. That is ridiculous. Like, it's...
Yeah, so that intro sort of covers what happens in the graphic novels.
Yeah. It's bad to condense three graphic novels into a 2-minute scene.
Yes, it's like, bad to have three graphic novels worth of backstory for your movie.
Yeah, it's just
make another movie at that point.
Yeah, it sounds like something that a lot of people fall under, myself included, where it's like they have an idea, it starts off with an idea, and then it is a change in your mind fest until the movie is done. Where you, like, it sounds like that's exactly the case, because it started off simple and then stuff happened in the news where you wanted to adjust the script based on that. And that's a really good way to fuck up what you had. Even if what you had wasn't, like, amazing, that's a good way to make it worse. Yeah. And I've done that before, actually. I back in my days of making films in college with friends, I had this big project that I kept wanting to adjust based on things I saw or thoughts I was having. And sometimes you just gotta trust your initial gut. Like, if you want to do a rewrite to make a script better, that's all good. But, like, if that rewrite involves adding so much extra shit in and cutting a lot of your original ideas out, it's like, yeah, this is probably not gonna work.
Well, I was watching, like, some behind-the-scenes stuff with Richard Kelly, and apparently, like, he was, like, unhappy with the ending for the twins in this movie, because he's like, I don't know, they make the ice cream truck fly and then they just kind of watch from there. And so then his idea was like, oh, what if they're the same person? And he added this whole, like, time travel plot to the movie, and it's like, why?
Yeah, it really, yeah, I don't think he knows what he was doing with this. I do not think he knows what he was doing.
In fairness, I have not said my broad thoughts on this. I actually really enjoy this movie. Now, I don't think it's good at all. And even as, like, a funny bad movie, I think it is only going to be to certain people's taste. I think most people are probably not going to enjoy this the way I did. Now, I get anyone who, like, unironically enjoys this. Mm-hmm. I am someone who very much ironically enjoys this.
Uh-huh.
I don't know, because, like, I love, like, batshit conservative media, and this is sort of like the other foot. It's like, oh, what if we did batshit conservative media but for the leftist crowd?
I think that, like I said, there's sequences that I like, and there is some stuff that I'm laughing pretty hard at, and part of me thinks it's supposed to be funny, but because of how weird this movie is, I can't tell. Like, the one scene where the woman's saying she's gonna shoot herself if Dwayne The Rock Johnson doesn't let her suck his dick, like, that made me laugh. That made me laugh pretty hard, actually. It's because of how scene. Yeah, it's because of how seriously, like, it's taken itself. Like, they're fully committed to that scene. But it's probably supposed to be funny, but it's also just, like, it's sad that I have to ask myself that.
Pimps don't commit suicide.
Pimps don't commit suicide. It was just a movie where it's, like, it wasn't boring me, per se. But here, go into more of why you like it. I'm sorry.
I just like that it's so weird and disorganized, and
mm-hmm.
and, like, impossible to follow. Well, I mean, here's the weird thing about it, is, like, there's a lot of scenes where, like, for a lot of the film, it's unclear what he's trying to say, and then there will be scenes in the movie where it's, like, super obvious what he's trying to say. Like, he will hit you over the head with it, and it's, like, those parts make the parts where you don't get what's going on worse, because it's almost like, were you saying anything with this? Because in the moments where I know you're trying to say something, it's very obvious what you're trying to say. Right. So when you move on and you're not saying anything suddenly, it's like, did you have something to say, or were you just being weird? Were you just being artsy?
Right.
This is, you know, the director of Donnie Darko, and it does feel similar to Donnie Darko in some ways. Like, it does make sense that this is from the director of Donnie Darko. Donnie Darko also has this, like, weird time travel thing going on that doesn't make a whole lot of sense, but it's, like, the only weird sci-fi thing in the movie. It's that's the thing. Donnie Darko is better than this for two big reasons. One, it is way more focused. There is one main character. He is doing one thing. Even if it is not entirely clear what that one thing is, it is at least like, okay, well, this is the movie, so I am willing to accept that maybe I don't understand some of what is going on, just to, like, follow along with the story. Where in this, like, shit's going weird, and it's like, even if I knew what this meant, I still wouldn't understand the story. Yeah. The other thing, Donnie Darko is really funny, right? It is way funnier than this movie. Like you said, there are moments where it's funny and it's, like, trying to be, but those moments... Not a lot. Yeah, I feel like those moments are so rare in this movie, where Donnie Darko has this great sense of humor, and I think that carries the film even through the moments where you start to go, what's going on?
Right. I think this movie also just, like, you just mentioned, like, okay, it has one character it's focused on. That's a big thing to mention with this movie. Because character-wise, there's, like, there are a lot of characters, and some of them I get what they're going for. Others, it's like, why? Like, I really don't see, like, I'm sure that there was a point trying to be made, but, like, from a narrative perspective and from a character perspective, Justin Timberlake, I do not think he needed to be in there. I don't think that female military, like, woman who just keeps popping up talking over the phone, I don't think she needed to be there. I don't really think the one woman who was obsessed with Dwayne The Rock Johnson's character, even though I did find that scene funny, I don't think she needed to be there. I don't think that the wheelchair guy, Kevin Smith, I don't think he needed to be there. I it's just so many characters. Bai Ling, the one, like, the one woman who has, like, a weird scene with Dwayne The Rock Johnson at the end. I don't understand what she added to it. Like, it's just so many nothing characters in this.
Kevin Smith's character feels like Kevin Smith was a huge fan of Donnie Darko, and he's like, yo, let me be in your movie, and, like, because, like, so much of what he says is, like, D&D references, weirdly, so it almost feels like Kevin Smith was just sort of improvising, and, like, Richard Kelly just, like, put him in the movie because it's like, oh, it's Kevin Smith, he was such a big fan of Donnie Darko, hell yeah, be in my movie, just, like, improvise.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, there's, like, way too many characters in this, and, like, so many of them I don't understand. Justin Timberlake, I'm willing to give a pass to. I think it's kind of funny that he's in the movie. I think he's, like, a funny character to have in the film.
I don't even really, like, hate his scenes. It's just, I don't really know what they add to it in the grand scheme of things. But also, I feel like this is a movie I just don't understand that well, so maybe I'm missing it.
I think what they're going for with Justin Timberlake's character is a little close, is sort of like Sam Elliott in Big Lebowski, like this narrator character who interacts with the story some, but not a lot.
Mm-hmm.
He's more an observer to the story, but he adds a bit of humor to the story, and he is the narrator. Although you and I both thought it was a woman for like 90% of the movie.
I'm surprised. I got to go back and listen to it. I'm surprised it isn't.
Like, yeah, I was like at the very end when like the narration refers to Justin Timberlake as me. I'm like, wait, is Justin Timberlake doing this narration? I thought it was a woman.
Is it possible they just switched them out at the end?
I don't think so. I think it was Justin Timberlake the whole movie. I think he was the one narrating, but it does sound like a woman for a lot of it. Now in the theatrical cut with like the opening like 2 minute
yeah, recap, that's clearly him.
Yeah, it's very clearly Justin Timberlake in that scene.
I guess we should talk about, like, I think we should talk about the casting in this movie more than in Waterworld. Yeah. Cause like we should talk about not just the like cast and choice, but the character. We've already done some. Okay. Let's start with, are you ready to start with that?
Sure. Yes. Let's talk about the people who appear in this film. Cause there are a lot of them.
Dwayne The Rock Johnson is so bad in this.
Really? I think this is like one of his more endearing performances.
I
like when he's like, I like seeing Dwayne Johnson be like this nervous, like nerdy guy sometimes. Like when he puts his fingers together and he looks all nervous, it's like kind of funny, I think.
Fair enough. I mean, it's definitely a bizarre performance, but I like, it's the scene where he's describing his plot. But to be fair, I'm sure some of that's the directing. But he's like pausing after every single word. It's just awkward to me. I thought it was a very awkward performance from him. And I don't even hate Dwayne The Rock Johnson. I think you give him the right thing, he's fine. The way you put it last night when we watched this is that he is an actor of charisma.
Yes.
I think that he, you know, what I've seen in Moana, I think he did that voice well. Even though it's mainly just his voice. But yeah, I mean, it works for the character he was going for in that.
Yeah,
I think he can be fine, but I
think watching the Fast and the Furious franchise really like highlights how good an actor he is, because he is like so much better than some of like the main actors in that series. Like he is acting circles around
Vin Diesel
and Paul Walker. He's better than Paul Walker too. May he rest in peace.
Yeah, I haven't seen any of those. The Rock is not like an actor that I hate. He's not one that he's not one that I love. But I didn't like his performance in this at all. I'm sorry, but just be the character that I don't like. Sean William Scott, I know him from one other movie. I swear I barely see this guy anywhere. He was in Role Models, which I did find funny when I was younger. But like in this, I didn't really get much of his performance in this either. It's just
he feels like he doesn't know what's going on in this movie either.
Like, right.
Like, the other actors are, like, doing a good job covering for the fact that this film makes no sense. He's kind of like, I don't know what's happening in this movie. Like, I genuinely have no clue what is happening in this movie.
Wasn't there an interview where someone in this admitted they didn't know what the movie was about?
Probably.
It may have even been Sean William Scott. I don't remember who it was.
It seems very likely that one or more of the actors in this has come out and said they had no idea what was happening in the movie. Because most people don't know what's happening in the movie. I'm right. Not sure Richard Kelly knew what was happening in the movie.
Sarah Michelle Gellar, I mean, for what the character was, I guess it was fine. Yeah. But I didn't like it. Again, it's just like I don't like the character.
I thought it was a decent performance. I kind of like that character, actually. Krista Now, the porn star with her own talk show and energy drink and pop album.
I think if they went goofier with it, I could have liked it more, honestly. It's weird. Like, it's almost one of the things where maybe they could step it up. Like, I could see a character like that in, like, BoJack, you know?
Listen, teen horniness is not a crime is a fucking banger. That is a great track. The music in this movie is good. I really like the music.
I was gonna say, like, both like the soundtrack that they, like, you know, the license song that they chose for this, I thought worked. I think they fit a lot of scenes really well, and I think some of the score is actually good. I think that the score is like a pretty decent film score. I think I should compliment before we continue with the cast, and I think a lot of it shot well. There's some sequences I honestly really like the entire sequence where they go, like, they're about to do, like, the fake shootout and then a real cop comes. Just because it's like, oh shit, how is this going to turn out? Like, I mean, to me, it was pretty obvious what was about to happen, but it was like, it's still like, it's something that, like, kind of changes, like, creates a shift in the movie, you know? Like, you know about this plan that's going to go on for a while, and then when it finally happens, there's something that throws the entire thing off. Like, that to me is interesting. And then the scene where they're, like, running out of the place and, shot William Scott's, like, looking at Dwayne The Rock Johnson, who's, like, whispering something to him and he can't even hear what it is because he's still in shock. Like, I liked that. I thought there was, like, some good details in that scene presentation-wise, but I don't think it's accompanying a movie with, like, I don't know, I feel like it could work in a different movie, you know?
Yeah.
Where I don't really, like, at the end of the day, it's like, I think it's a neat sequence, but what it's, like, overall contributing to, it doesn't mean a lot to me.
We have avoided saying that John Lovitz is the cop who shows up.
Yeah. Which is,
I mean, like, all of the cast in this, it's like, what are you doing in this movie? Like, every single actor, it's like, what are you doing in this movie?
Amy Poehler threw me off.
Yeah, I mean, this was before she was on SNL, wasn't it? Or what? Maybe it was, like, right when she was on.
Yeah. I think that's probably I think it was when she was on. Because she was, like, playing Hillary Clinton during, like, the 2008 election, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
And this movie came out a year before that, so.
No, this came out in 2006, I think.
It says the USA, it was November 14th, 2007, but maybe that's referring to, like, festival releases.
Well, 2006 might be referring to festival releases, which is why I say that. Okay, no, 2007. This is a 2007 film.
Okay. But, I mean, I think, honest to God, I think for what the character was, Amy Poehler worked for that. It's a little goofy. I don't know. I almost feel like her and Sarah Michelle Gellar could work in, like, a movie that was, like, more blatantly trying to be a comedy.
Yeah. Just, like, exaggerated versions of, like, people we see in the real world.
Yeah. It's also, like, kind of like I mentioned BoJack before, because I think that's a show that loves to reference, like, you know, pretentious people in Hollywood.
Yeah.
It's like, yeah, both of these two characters fit that quota pretty well.
BoJack does what Southland Tales was trying to do way better than Southland Tales does. Granted, BoJack had six seasons.
Right, it had six seasons, but, like, yeah, you can look at...
Honestly,
when you're making an episode of a show and you're making a movie, you should have focus on both.
If he had made this, like, a TV series and, like, really leaned into it, like do, like, a Twin Peaks type TV series where it's just, like, weird stuff keeps happening and you keep going, where's this going, what's this leading to, it might have been a better movie.
I agree 100%. Let's see, looking for this list, who was Michelle Durrett again? Was she the I'll suck your dick woman?
Maybe.
No, wait, maybe she, or was she, like, the
one woman
in the office? That was, like, the woman in the office, right? I have no fucking idea who she played, to be honest.
Yeah, no, I don't think it's important.
Yeah, there's that one woman who's, like, sitting in an office at the entire movie, and at the end she gets shot.
Yes.
I don't think she was a very interesting character, but she's just kind of one they kept going to.
Miranda Richardson, that's who that is.
Okay. Cherry Oteri played Zora. How do you say the name? Cherry?
Maybe Sherry, but... Yeah, I'm gonna say... Well, her real name is Cheryl, so I'm gonna say Sherry.
Sure. Okay. Playing Zora. Zora was a character that annoyed me. I was happy when she died. But I mean, I won't say she necessarily didn't work for the movie. I mean, for that subplot, she worked. Wallace Shawn is normally a little bit, he's always fun to listen to.
Yeah, I'm not sure there's like a few characters where it's like really unclear whose side they're on and whether or not they're supposed to be like good guys or bad guys and who they're allied with and who they're backstabbing. And
yeah,
Wallace Shawn is one of them.
Yeah,
I did appreciate that one of his assistants was Curtis Armstrong, because those are two actors I have mistaken for each other before.
Yeah, they did. So I did like hear the, like, you mentioned that, like, yeah, he does sound pretty similar. We mentioned Will Sasso.
Christopher Lambert is in there as this like weapons dealer who's also driving the ice cream truck with Ronald Tavner in it, or Roland I don't remember which one's Roland and which one's Ronald, even though they're the same person. They're the same person. Plot twist, there was time travel. I don't get it.
Yeah.
Christopher Lambert, it's an interesting character, but I think he's sort of miscast in that role.
Yeah, I wasn't too big on that character.
I kind of like him. He's someone we will almost definitely see again.
I think there's a lot of people in this that we can see again.
John Lovett's also someone we will probably see again. Dwayne The Rock Johnson, almost definitely we will see him again.
Sarah Michelle Gellar, if we ever want to do Scooby-Doo, she'll be there.
Sarah Michelle Gellar, potentially. Justin Timberlake, potentially, yeah. Honestly.
Yeah, a lot of the, I mean, honest to God, Justin Timberlake and Michelle, they, like, Sarah Michelle, they could be, like, fucking Yogi Bear versus Scooby-Doo, you know? We'll see. You know, so a lot of these SNL comedians you'll see pop up again just because, like, a lot of them are very talented people, but SNL comedians are just, like, infamous for being in bad comedies.
Yeah. Yeah, no, you get, like, a big studio comedy, and it's like, who do we get? Let's SNL alum. Give us the SNL alum. You know what movie we really should have paired this up with?
What?
Don't Look Up.
Oh my God, yes.
That would have worked. They're both, like, extremely on the nose, very, very timely, very topical political commentary. Both are just chock full of, like, the hottest celebrities of the day.
Yeah.
Well, and I mean, they're both end of the world stories.
They're both end of the world stories, and I think they're both up their own asses.
Yes. Now, like, Southland Tales is infinitely more enjoyable than Don't Look Up, because it's at least weird and nonsensical.
I think Don't Look Up is easier to follow, but yes. It's like,
but honestly, I kind of enjoy, I almost would say I enjoy Southland Tales more,
because I might
it's
agree. Not
as easy to follow, because it's just so weird, and there's nothing like Southland Tales, you know? You don't make movies like this.
They're probably pretty close for me, if I'm just being honest.
And yet, one of them was nominated for Best Picture, and one of them wasn't.
Wait, really? Is that, like, really?
Don't Look Up was nominated for Best Picture.
Oh, I thought you were saying between Water. Oh my God, I'm stupid. I'm sorry. I just had, like, a complete brain fart there. I was thinking you were saying, like, Pearl, like, it was either Waterworld or Southland Tales.
I mean, it's possible Waterworld pulled a nomination for, like, effects. That wouldn't surprise me.
We have another actor in this movie who's appeared on Hall of Victories before.
Yeah, look at that. Oh, Best Sound. It was nominated for Best Sound. That's weird.
Beth Grant was in The Wizard. Nora Dunn was the blackmailer, and I think Lisa K. Wyatt was her friend, but now I'm not so sure. There's too many fucking characters in this movie.
There are way too many characters in this movie.
What else is there to talk about with this? I think I'm good. I'm good. Good personally on casting. Is there anyone else you wanted to bring up?
Nope.
There was a lot. There was a lot of people to talk about, though. That was a lot.
Yeah. No. Like big cast.
The I think some good shots. I agree with you on the soundtrack.
Yeah, and that opening was actually we talked about like how the opening scene is pretty good.
Yeah.
I listened to a little bit of the audio commentary for this. Apparently they just like gave two kids cameras at like an actual 4th of July party.
That's believable. Yeah, I felt that all came off very natural. Like every single shot of that felt pretty real, just like with the way people acted. Like just how some of the people reacted to like having a camera pointed at them, that felt very natural.
You know, like there's the old lady who like squirts them with the water gun and she's like, yeah. Oh no, I didn't know it had water in it.
It's yeah. Like,
yeah, it feels very natural.
Yeah. And I like the score for that scene a lot too. I like how horrifying it is when the explosion goes off. You see through the window and they walk outside. Like, I mean, that was handled well.
Uh-huh. You know who did the soundtrack for this?
Who?
Moby.
Oh. I like Moby.
I have no strong feelings one way or the other.
He did like music that was played in Stranger Things. He did he has like this little cartoon character named Little Idiot, who's supposed to be like a representation of him. I enjoy his music. I'm not like a super fan or anything, but I've enjoyed some of his music. It's a good accompaniment for projects. I'll probably actually use one of his tracks in a video someday. Because I just take whatever I fucking want.
I might someday review his Christmas movie.
He made a Christmas movie.
Yes, it's titled Alien Sex Party.
Oh boy. That's almost like, that's like one word off of Ninja Sex Party.
Yes.
Yeah.
Indeed it is.
So yeah, any other like topics of this movie we want to go into?
Oh shit, I did have something and I kind of forgot what it was. Yeah. Oh, I was going to talk about the effects, cuz the effects are not very good.
Yeah, I will say
the blue screen is so bad.
The blue screen is pretty bad. Like that ice cream truck floating at the end doesn't look very good. That's another sequence though I almost like. I like how dreamlike it is. Like where it's like it feels like something you'd see out of a dream where there's like this weird dancing scene going on. Meanwhile, it keeps cutting back to this, like, one guy who barely was in any of the movie, like, standing on top of an ice cream gun with a fucking bazooka.
Yeah.
And
I like that they set up the bazooka, too.
Yeah, like. I'll give it that. I like that scene, though. It's just, like, very dreamlike kind of music video-like. Like, I enjoyed that. But again, I wish it was in service of a better movie. But I do, the effects are bad.
I wish this movie was more dreamlike, honestly. Like, yeah. Either it needed to be, like, way more focused and be, like, a goofy comedy, or it needed to go, like, really weird, really trippy, go, like, full David Lynch with this.
And, yeah, but I still think it needs to, like, have a basic idea of what it wants to say. Like, I like weird, trippy movies, but most of those, like, do at least have a thought process, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. It's like exactly, I think you said it best at the beginning. Where it's like, it's a movie that someone thinks about in their head without actually fleshing it out.
Yeah. Usually you do not get this on the screen. This is the type of thing that only exists in your head.
Yeah. I can get why some people might appreciate it. I can get why some people, like, might be interesting. It is stand out, but it's just one of those where it's like,
that's an interesting movie.
It's one, you know, there's a reason I am willing to rank it higher than like right under, because even if I didn't have that like level of respect for it, I probably would have ranked it higher than Joystick. But yeah. But because of, like, what it is and, like, the potential that some of it has, I'll put it over, like, I'll put it over like the major product movies we've talked about, you know, like it's going over like Care Bears or Marmaduke, where it's like, this isn't like something that someone was, maybe there was someone about who worked on the movie that liked what they were making, but this is not someone's passion project.
Southland Tales very much is.
Yeah. Southland Tales isn't just a product, you know?
It's misguided. It's completely aimless. But
yeah,
it is the movie Richard Kelly wanted to make, and I think people respect that about it.
Yeah, and I guess I say this a lot. I kind of want to clarify something. Being a product isn't like inherently evil or a bad thing. There are movies that I would consider products that I enjoy, you know, but when it's bad, it's a lot harder to be sympathetic towards it, because it's like, it's like someone fucking up your food at a restaurant. It's like, no, I paid for something and you fucked it up. When it's like an artist making a movie, it's like, you want to support them because you want more people like that in that industry.
Yeah.
But yeah, like Southland Tales, not my thing. I'm not too alone with that, though.
No, yeah, no, that's completely fair. I understand that entirely.
Yeah.
I told you before we went into it, I had no idea how you were going to react to it.
I was going to say, I wish I could have been right there with you. I wish this could have been like a Southland Tales appreciation episode, you know, where it's like, no, I see what you see in it, too, and we just talk about it. But I'm glad you liked it. I mean, I'm glad, even if it's not like 100% for sincere reasons, I'm glad you get something out of it. And I'm glad I saw it finally, because, oh my god, I've heard so much discourse about this movie over the years.
Yeah.
Now I kind of get it. I'm on the negative side, but I do get it now.
Like, if I was gonna show one of these movies to someone, like, if we weren't doing this for Hollow Victories and I had to pick one of these movies to show you, I would probably show you Southland Tales, because as enjoyable as Waterworld is, I think it can turn into a bit of a slog, where this is not a slog. It may not be fun, but it will be interesting the entire time.
Yeah, I did not get bored watching this. But I did. But I don't think I was, like, in pain watching Waterworld. I know it sounds dramatic, but...
Yeah, have we moved on to the voting portion of the evening?
I suppose so.
All right. I think I know exactly which way this is going, but I'll let you go first.
So I'm voting for Southland Tales. I'm voting for Waterworld.
All right. Well, you know what? I am also voting for Waterworld.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think Southland Tales I enjoy, but Waterworld is definitely... It comes down to this, right? If you wanted to make Waterworld a better movie, all you have to do is reel it back. It's just, it's too big, it's too dramatic. Just make it a simple action movie. And the stuff that works about it works because it's a simple action movie. Where I think very little unironically works about Southland Tales. I think you would have to make major overhauls to this movie to make it good.
You would need to focus on like an idea or two that you like in that movie and redo the entire thing.
Yes. So, somewhat bizarrely, like, the audience is on our side with this one. Waterworld has overtaken last episode. This is now a 92% to 8% for Waterworld. Southland Tales... fewer votes for Southland Tales than Cat in the Hat, or at least a smaller percentage of the vote for Southland Tales than Cat in the Hat. Although, looking at it, there were more votes on the last poll, so yeah, probably fewer votes for Southland Tales than than for Cat in the Hat.
Yeah.
Woof. And I mean I know people who Like there are people who really love Southland Tales, so if any of those people are listening, like, please don't get too upset at us. Like,
oh yeah, I mean, I hope that I'm glad that you got something out of it. And I mean, like, if you want to argue with me about that, go ahead. I actually will read your comment. Just don't be malicious to me.
Yes, please, please let us know why you like Southland Tales. Not that I don't get it, but I would definitely like to hear more from someone who enjoys the film.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. For unironic reasons.
This probably was, like, one of my more, like, talking down episodes. I don't know, like, this and Joysticks, it feels like I just... Like, with Last Airbender, it just kind of felt obvious that it was going to be like that.
Yeah.
But with Joysticks and Southland Tales, I definitely think it's, like, the most I've talked down a movie. So I guess I understand if someone listened to this and got annoyed by what I said about it, but... I'll hear you out. I'll hear you out. I'll give you a like or respond to your comment if I think what you said is if you make a good point, you know.
The Waterworld wins.
Yeah.
Next time on Hollow Victories, I tend to be pretty good in a lot of my shows about like showcasing foreign work, but Hollow Victories has been very, very. America-centric, especially, but Anglo-centric. There have been a few movies from, like, Britain, and there's probably, like, one from Canada in there somewhere. But, like, mostly, it's all stuff from the Anglosphere, right? It's mostly American films. And granted, that's because we go for movies with a reputation, and American films tend to have more of a reputation. So next time we're finally venturing forth, we're finally looking at some foreign films. We're going to the far-off land of Turkey for two of their greatest rip-off movies. I am speaking, of course, about The Man Who Saved the World, aka Turkish Star Wars, versus 3Dev Adam, the Turkish Spider-Man Captain America El Santo movie.
Interesting. I've heard of the Star Wars one. I haven't heard of the other one.
This one will be fun. This is, okay, like, gonna be one of the funnest episodes we do.
Yeah, I hope this one was fun to listen to. I'll admit I was kind of defeated. I wasn't sure what to expect, but...
I think this was a good matchup. I was very happy to get to talk about both of these films, and I enjoyed rewatching them.
I did enjoy the conversation about them. it was a rougher one to sit through.
Yeah, that's fair. They were both fairly long, both not entirely watchable movies.
Yeah, Waterworld would have been fine if it wasn't fucking three hours.
Yeah. Yes.
But yeah, looking forward to it. That'll be. I'm glad that we're getting something different for this next one.
Yeah.
Although I definitely say that was the case with this episode too.
Yes. Yeah, we're branching out a little.
Yeah.
Although after this, we're going back to the corporate product.
Oh hell yeah! Gotta get in Marmaduke the Netflix movie.
We gotta wait for the Chris Pratt Garfield to come out.
I don't... Okay, fine, I guess.
Anything else?
No.
All right. Then for my co-host, Makal Shadakal, I'm Matt Presents. We'll see you in the next one.
Peace.